Thank you. That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is a debate on motion 6443 in the name of Patrick Harvey on Energy Prices Bill UK legislation. And I would invite members who wish to speak in the debate to please press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Patrick Harvey to speak to and move the motion. Up to 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the motion at the outset. I would like to thank the Chamber for consideration of this legislative consent memorandum in relation to the UK Government's Emergency Energy Prices Bill. Now, as ever, whenever we discuss reserved energy legislation, we must remind ourselves once again of the many vital actions that this Parliament could choose to take directly if the powers to do so were not reserved. That frustration is heightened today by the challenging timescales within which we've had to work in order to allow Parliament the time needed to consider the implications for Scotland. Given the focus of the LCM in supporting people through the most acute energy prices pressures in living memory, I do absolutely understand the speed with which it is progressing through the UK Parliament. Indeed, of course, just before recess, I was overseeing our own emergency legislation on support for tenants during the cost crisis. So I recognise, and I hope that members across the Chamber today will recognise, the very constrained circumstances in which we're considering the motion today. Before turning to the specific issues requiring consideration, I want to emphasise just how much the urgent need for the intervention in prices within this legislation is driven by our vulnerability to gas prices. This crisis continues to highlight our reliance, indeed over-reliance, on gas as a means of heating so many of our homes and buildings, leaving our energy prices at the mercy of a hugely volatile market. So, as we do everything we can to support people through the crisis in the immediate term, it remains absolutely essential that we accelerate our transition away from fossil fuels for heat. Meanwhile, no sooner has the UK Government laid this emergency bill, which seeks to be passed at breakneck speed, than it cuts short its flagship policy on energy support. This curtailing of the energy price guarantee by the Chancellor last week has plunged households back into uncertainty about their bills and finances. Many of these households are already faced with making stark choices between providing food or warmth for themselves and their families. That's why we have called repeatedly for additional targeted support for vulnerable consumers. The Chancellor's reversal of what had been a 2-year energy price guarantee makes this all the more urgent. We estimate that there are now 860,000 households in Scotland living in fuel poverty and 600,000 in extreme fuel poverty. So while we have committed to doubling our fuel insecurity fund to £20 million as part of the emergency budget review that we're progressing, much more needs to be done with both the power and resources that exist at UK level. I'll move on now, Presiding Officer, to the issues within the bill that Parliament needs to consider today. We've identified 5 clauses in the bill that require Parliament's consent. These provisions cover the reduction of domestic energy bills, the reduction of non-domestic energy bills, support for meeting energy costs and regulation of energy markets. The first 4 of the 5 clauses, that's clauses 13, 14, 15 and 19, relate to support for consumers in meeting energy costs. As set out in the draft memorandum, the powers exercised by clause 13 could be used in a way that relate to devolved competence. The example used in the draft LCM is in the use of the power to provide financial assistance to meet or reduce expenses for heating in cold weather. Based on the urgency for people across Scotland to receive financial assistance to mitigate the impact of this crisis, the Scottish Government does recommend that Parliament consents to Clause 13 and the related Clause 14. Clauses 15 and 19 will enable the delivery of support such as the equivalent to the £400 delivered through the Energy Bills Support Scheme to those who were previously not eligible. Examples of consumers who are eligible for this equivalent support are park homeowners and students living in rented accommodation. Last week, the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport wrote to the Secretary of State to seek urgent assurance that everyone in Scotland who is entitled will now receive the £400 rebate. Earlier this year, Parliament raised concerns around second home owners benefiting from the Energy Bill Support Scheme discount. Our limited powers mean that we could not prevent second home owners from benefiting twice from the £400 energy rebate in the way that we would have wanted. The Cabinet Secretary did, of course, formally request an amendment to the Energy Prices Bill to prevent such an outcome, but this has not been accepted. While this remains deeply disappointing, we have been given an explicit understanding that the forthcoming equivalent support will be awarded via an application process and only apply to primary addresses. Presiding Officer, Clause 22 gives power to the Secretary of State to give directions to energy licence holders in response to the energy crisis and is not limited to activities in reserved areas. So the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport wrote to the BIS Secretary of State on the 19th of October to request that the bill be amended to require Scottish Ministers' consent before any direction is given affecting a devolved area. In coming to a conclusion, Presiding Officer, I would like to express the hope that the latest forced regeneration at the top of the UK Government might also compel a reappraisal of some of the glaring gaps in its energy policies. A prime example of a step in the right direction would be an immediate commitment to require and fund a major programme of energy efficiency measures and improvements. This would not only make homes more comfortable and affordable to heat, it would improve our environment and security of supply as well by reducing our dependence on fossil fuels and indeed reducing the power that's exercised at the whim of countries such as Russia and its current leader. And while I would again reflect that the UK Energy Prices Bill is far less than it might be were the powers behind its creation available to this Parliament, it remains better than nothing. So consenting to this motion will allow the people of Scotland who are currently struggling to pay their energy bills and heat their homes to receive desperately needed financial assistance as quickly as possible. And I therefore must recommend that this Parliament consents to the UK Energy Prices Bill as it stands. I move the motion.
Thank you. I now call on Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak in this debate on whether Parliament should consent to an LCM on the Energy Prices Bill. In the first place, I should say I join with the Minister in supporting that Rule 9B.3.5 be suspended in relation to the LCM on the Energy Prices Bill. As I've made very clear in previous debates, I'm rarely comfortable suspending standing orders to move bills or LCMs through without full process and particularly consideration by the relevant committee. And I think on that note, it bears mentioning that the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee, within whose remit this LCM falls, has, in my view, and I declare an interest as a member, shown itself to be an effective and non-partisan scrutiny body which adds significant value to LCM considerations. However, in this case, like the Minister earlier, I note that the Energy Prices Bill is going through as emergency legislation. I note also it will complete its final amending stage today, which is also the day of the Net Zero Committee, and royal assent is expected tomorrow, the 26th of October. I further understand, in relation to the processes, that following consultation, the convener of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee is content with the suspension of standing orders, such that a lead committee report would not be required in this case. In the circumstances, therefore, the Scottish Conservatives will be content to support the expedited process. Turning to the substantive LCM, the Scottish Conservatives welcome the Energy Prices Bill. By providing the legislative framework to deliver the government's energy price guarantee and energy bill relief scheme, it will provide much needed support to households and businesses right across the UK. No one has been unaffected by the eye-watering rise in wholesale prices of gas and oil in the past couple of years. That's resulted from a range of global factors, including countries recovering from the COVID-19 pandemic, and of course the reduction in Russian supplies to Europe following the appalling invasion of Ukraine. Which is why I agree with Patrick Harvey that energy security is so important in this country, and why there is, and that is why that is yet another reason why we should support our North Sea oil and gas industry. It is our understanding that this bill will cap the cost of electricity and gas per unit for domestic customers for a period of 6 months until the 1st of April 2023. The purpose being that the average household, a defined term, would see annual energy bills of £2,500 rather than £3,549 that was otherwise projected. And furthermore, the bill appears to write in an equivalent price guarantee for businesses, charities and public sector organisations for the duration of that 6 months. It is only 6 months, but unlike Mr Harvey, I feel that is the right length of time to get us through the winter and then have a review that, which will ensure that the mechanism can be stress tested against what was projected, what was intended and what we have actually seen by that point in practice during the winter months, and then to decide what is the best and most productive mechanism going forward. So I think that the energy prices bill is the right way forward, but as ever, where an action of the UK government would make changes in Scotland, it is absolutely right that this Parliament consider whether to agree to it. I've listened to the Minister propose that this Parliament give its consent to the Scottish provisions of the Energy Prices Bill, and on that I agree with him. And interestingly, the Minister suggested in his peroration that this Parliament doesn't have the powers to do all that it wants to. But I remind him, of course, of my speech right before recess, which he conveniently appears to have forgotten, in which I pointed out this Parliament does have all the powers he needs. And indeed, thanks to the largest ever budget settlement in devolution history, it also has the funds to do what it needs. Presiding Officer, the UK Government is doing the right thing to try and help consumers, businesses, charities and the like during this difficult time, and it's important that the Scottish Government, the Scottish Parliament, both acknowledges and welcomes that. The Energy Prices Bill and the attendant LCM will provide a lifeline to households and businesses this winter. Therefore, the bill should not be delayed and should be added to the statute book as soon as practically possible. Accordingly, I have no hesitation in confirming the Scottish Conservatives intend to support the motion consenting to the UK Parliament legislating on devolved matters in this bill. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Labour has called for support for families and businesses through an energy price freeze since August, setting out detailed costed plans, so we support the passage of this bill through the UK Parliament, even if the bill was described as a landmark two-year price guarantee but has now been shredded to a six-month freeze. The devolved provisions that require Scottish Parliament consent are likely to be limited in practice, and we welcome the efforts of the Scottish Government to seek assurances that the direction given powers will not be used to cut across devolved competencies such as planning. And we also recognise the time-limited nature of most of the powers in the bill. So given the urgency of the matter, the dire cost of living crisis we face, we share the Scottish Government's view that seeking to carve out certain aspects of the support for separate provision from the Scottish Government is not appropriate or practical, and therefore we support giving consent to this LCM. These are urgent, desperate times for far too many families having to choose between heating and eating, and far too many businesses and organisations are left wondering whether they'll soon have to switch off the lights for the final time. Although we are supportive of the help with energy costs the bill enables, we still have concerns over substantive parts of the legislation, and Labour and the UK Parliament have been seeking to amend the bill. There's a contrast between the UK Government proposals and those proposed by Labour in August. Labour proposed a real freeze. The UK Government have allowed a rise, albeit one that is capped. There also remains concerns over off-grid households, and of course we have a profound disagreement over how the support will be funded. It's no secret that Labour wants to see this package of support funded not by more government borrowing, which ultimately ordinary families will have to pay back, and a limited windfall tax, but primarily through a substantive windfall tax on the excess additional profits of the big oil and gas firms and the closing of loopholes in support provided for fossil fuel companies. The Energy, Oil and Gas Profits Levy Act 2022 included a significant loophole for oil and gas companies that invest more in oil and gas exploration and production. According to the Treasury, the allowance will mean businesses will receive a 91p tax saving for every £1 invested, nearly doubling the tax relief available to oil and gas companies, tilting the pitch in favour of fossil fuel investment over renewable investment. Labour would like to see this loophole closed, bringing over £5 billion to the table, and we've been seeking to pursue this through amendments in the UK Parliament, albeit recognising the limited scope of the bill itself. There is, of course, far more the Scottish Government itself can do to support families, businesses and organisations at this time, cancelling school meal debt, increasing funding for money advice services, topping up the welfare fund, and that will be the focus of Labour's business in the Chamber tomorrow. But the focus of this bill and the LCM highlights why we need to recognise the lessons of this energy crisis. Those lessons are not the need to drive forward with fracking, which was the plan of last week's Prime Minister, though I'm not sure what the view is of this week's Prime Minister. The lessons are the need for a sprint for clean energy, for solar, for wind, for nuclear, for energy efficiency, and the need for a publicly owned energy fund that the next Labour government will deliver where others have failed to do so. And there's also a need to de-link electricity and gas prices within a clear timetable so we don't find ourselves facing the requirement for another bill in the near future. However, in the meantime, this bill is necessary, it's urgent, and indeed it's overdue. Therefore, Labour is content to support this LCM today. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Liam MacArthur.
Thank you very much, President. Can I start by echoing very much the bulk of what Colin Smith has just said in terms of the criticisms over the energy prices bill and the package put forward, both in terms of its extent, its duration, and indeed the way in which the funds are to be provided. I think the extension of the windfall tax on oil and gas companies' profits was the obvious way of extending this rather than saddling the public taxpayers in years to come with that additional debt. I think both he and the Minister were also right to point to the fact that what we're also seeing is an approach by the UK government that appears to provide greater latitude for further development in oil and gas, but actually is risk-curbing some of the development in terms of renewables. I think everybody accepts that in the current circumstances, acting with urgency is absolutely what the public would expect. But at the same time, I think, as always with emergency legislation, we need to be alive to the potential unintended consequences of what's being proposed. And it's in relation to one of those that I want to focus my brief remarks this afternoon. It's in relation to the cap on profits made by renewable developments, probably under the renewable obligation certificates, but also under the FIT scheme as well. And as Community Energy Scotland highlighted to the Cabinet Secretary and indeed to party spokespeople earlier this week, there is the potential for inadvertently and unnecessarily hurting local communities by the way in which the Energy Prices Bill is framed at the moment. Community Energy Scotland, along with our sister organisations in England and Wales, has sought an exemption for community-owned wind farms, solar farms and hydro schemes that reinvest their surplus back into local communities. And that seems to be an appeal that is very legitimately made, and one that whatever the rationale for capping the profits of these older renewable developments, it doesn't seem to serve any useful public purpose whatsoever. I've got one example in my own constituency which I think perfectly illustrates this. I met the chair of Hoy Energy Limited last week. Hoy Energy Limited runs a 900 kilowatt wind turbine generator on behalf of its parent organisation, the Island of Hoy Development Trust, which itself is a registered charity. And HEL remits all of its net profits to the Development Trust, and the Trust uses this income to support community bus service, community centre and welfare officer, as well as providing grant support for a range of other community projects, supports on an occasional basis, education, training, school trips and so on. It's also looking at providing support through a separate charity for domestic electricity generation and storage scheme to help reduce fuel poverty in a part of the country where which endures the highest level of fuel poverty and extreme fuel poverty anywhere in Scotland and indeed the UK. So, as I say, whatever the merits of the approach that's been taken, it seems to me highly unlikely that the intention is to cut across the profits of community-based developments such as this, which do not provide dividends for shareholders, who are not providing profits in a sense for profit's sake, but simply to reinvest those back into community projects for community benefit, or indeed investing in repowering initiatives that will prolong the life of these projects, providing sustained income into these communities. Now, I hope even at this late stage where the Minister would take this up with his UK counterparts on behalf of Community Energy Scotland to see, even if at the 11th hour, some progress can be made in securing this exemption. But on the basis that others have already said, Scottish Liberal Democrats will be supporting the LCM this afternoon.
Thank you. And I now call on Minister Patrick Harvey to wind up.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I first of all pick up on that last point and say to Liam MacArthur that I will take his comments on board, discuss that with officials, and if we're able to give him any update on the government's position, I'll write to him on that. I would like to thank members for their contributions on the relatively short discussion on what we've all acknowledged is an urgent matter that needs to be considered quickly. I think it's widely acknowledged across the chamber that the process is not ideal, but that it is clearly necessary. And I welcome the fact that recognition has been given. So, albeit a short debate, it has been a helpful one, especially considering the very little time that we have available to consider the bill and its implication for devolved areas. Passing this LCM will at least ensure that the money that is available can be provided to those who need it as soon as possible. And the Scottish Government will continue to do what is within our powers to support people here in Scotland. But let's be clear, we do also need UK government action to ensure that all consumers can afford to heat their homes, not just this winter, but ensure that they can tackle fuel poverty well beyond that, and also that businesses can stay afloat. I give way.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. Just on the point of the Scottish Government trying to do what it can, correct me if I'm wrong, but the Scottish Government underspent its budget by £650 million last year. Now, one of the things that the Scottish Conservatives have proposed is a cost of living support fund. Why isn't the Minister proposing using that £650 million underspend to put a support fund in?
Minister.
I don't think we need a kind of remedial lesson in how the Scottish Government's finances work. Mr Kerr can take that up with his finance colleagues if he needs a lesson. I would like to close by reiterating our call on the UK Government to provide additional support to vulnerable consumers ahead of this winter, during this winter, and far beyond, and also to seek urgent clarity on the protection that consumers will have in the face of forthcoming price rises beyond April. That will include many people living in rural communities across Scotland who are facing higher living costs than others in more central areas. And let's remind ourselves, of course, again, that the devastating impact of skyrocketing energy prices on consumers are caused by a dependency, an over-dependency on natural gas, a dependency that we have to break, unlike Mr Kerr, who would suggest that we keep locking ourselves in to dependency on fossil fuels. So while we can help to ensure through our actions today that consumers are given vital support, we also have to keep in mind the need to accelerate our transition to net zero heating and a decarbonised energy system. To close briefly, Presiding Officer, it is necessary now, given the reversal of the two-year commitment, that we consider what the options might be after the first 6 months. And I would remind Mr Kerr that when the Scottish Conservatives weren't busy promoting the UK Government's disastrous tax plans, they were very happy to welcome that two-year commitment when it was first made. And so I don't think it quite cuts it to say now that 6 months is the right timescale, or indeed that this Parliament has all the powers we need. We can do nothing in this Parliament yet to regulate energy prices. We can do nothing in this Parliament yet to break the link that Labour colleagues rightly point out between gas and electricity prices, a commitment that's been given by the UK Government for a long time now, but which is hanging there, uncertain which minister will even be responsible for progressing it or when. And we can do nothing in this Parliament yet to give people in Scotland the benefit, the financial benefit, of cheap, clean, abundant, renewable electricity that's being generated in this country. This Parliament should be able to take much greater action to give people in Scotland the benefit of that renewable electricity and to tackle fuel poverty. For the time being, and until we have those greater powers, we will pass this LCM to ensure that people get the emergency support that they deserve and need.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Energy Prices Bill, UK legislation, and we'll move straight to the question, which is that motion 6443 in the name of Patrick Harvey on Energy Prices Bill, UK legislation, be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are. The motion is therefore agreed. And we will move on briefly to the next item.